Thank you. Well, good morning and welcome. At the outset, please accept my sincere condolences for the loss of such a well-loved man. Joe, I'm sure, would be missed by us all. The service this morning is being recorded. As I know, there would have been many, many more here had it not been for the current restrictions that we find ourselves under. I'm delighted to be able to say that through the wonders of modern technology, Iain's been able to join us, as you can see. And it's great to have him here with us this morning. And hopefully Iain will be able to say a few words later. As I mentioned, we are under a number of restrictions at the moment due to the pandemic. So could I ask you all, please, to keep your face coverings on at all times? And also, whilst we will be playing a number of hymns, if you could try and refrain from hymning, from singing. It's been suggested to me as well that you should try and refrain from humming, because the natural tendency will perhaps be just to break out into song. Those of us who are taking part are permitted to remove our masks, so we're not breaking the rules, but if you can keep yours on, that would be appreciated. At the end of the service, we need to exit through this door here, and Willie and Harry will lead us out at the end of that time. And if I can also ask that you just try and remember to observe the social distancing rules that are in place at this moment. I appreciate that will be very difficult. But perhaps I could ask you to stand now as we play the first hymn, which is Make Me a Channel of Your Peace.
Make me a channel of your peace. Where there is hatred, let me bring your love. Where there is injury, your pardon, Lord. And where there's doubt, true faith in you. Make me a channel. Despair in life, let me bring hope. Where there is darkness, only light. And where there's sadness, ever joy. Oh, Master, grant that I may never seek so much to be consumed as to console, to be understood as to understand, to be loved as to love with all my soul. Make me a channel of your peace. It is in pardoning that we are pardoned, in giving to all men that we receive, and in dying that we're born to eternal life. Oh, Master, grant that I may never seek so much to be consumed. As to understand, bring home. Where there is darkness, only light. And where there's sadness, ever joy. And where there's sadness, ever joy.
Please be seated. Shall we pray? Heavenly Father, we approach you this morning in the name of the one who declared himself to be the resurrection and the life. We ask that you will comfort those who mourn the loss of our dear brother in Christ, Joe Simpson, a husband, father, grandfather and great-grandfather, and a friend of many. Give grace and peace, we pray at this time. Help us to trust in your goodness and your mercy. Help us to cast all our cares on you so that we may know your comfort. Father, we seek thy face at this time and ask that you may bless us as we remember thy faithful servant. In thy son's holy and most precious name, amen. Our second hymn this morning is Abide With Me, and please feel free to remain seated for this. I'm going to ask Willie Dickson now to come and say a few words, and then once Willie has sat down, if Sarah perhaps could come and say some words as well.
Thank you, Tim. Maybe a verse from Proverbs just to set the tone of what I would like to share this morning. Choose a good reputation over great riches, for being held in high esteem is better than having silver or gold. The Bible tells us that these words were written by the wisest man who ever lived. And so maybe we should just take heed of them and what they say. Wouldn't it be a tragedy if at the end of our lives there were no kind words to say about us and only negative experiences of how we behaved or dealt with people we met through our time here on earth? There has been a trend some time now just within the media and within society to highlight the aggressive and abrasive behaviour and coarse and harsh words, uncaring and unfeeling attitudes towards others. But the words from the wisest man who ever lived stand in complete contrast to that philosophy. Choose a good reputation. Have a good name amongst your circle of family and friends. Have them smile when they speak your name. Have them say wholesome and heartwarming things about you. Have them miss you when you're not around. I'm sure we would all agree that Joe Simpson had that effect on people around him. Joe had a good reputation. He was indeed held in high esteem by others. Joe's name is quoted as coming from the Hebrew, meaning he shall add. And also, he was quiet and reserved, caring, strong principled, always fair, and expects the same from others. And you'll see those characteristics copied on the back of your order of service. And I feel, and I'm sure you agree, they sum up so well Joe Simpson, whom we all knew and loved. Joe was a true Christian gentleman who did have a care and a compassion for others. Not only did he possess these characteristics, he put them into practice. Joe was a doer. He constructed, he built up, he mended, he worked hard to put things right. Joe's life fell into three main compartments: his family, his work life, and his church life. And of course, they are all intertwined together and all influenced deeply by Joe's Christian faith. I was pleased to spend some time with Moira and the family just the other morning as they recalled some of the events of Joe's life. And I will try my best to share just a few stepping stones through his 86 years. And we do pray that this time of reflection and thanksgiving will be a help and a blessing to all. We obviously need to find comfort in times such as this. Yes, from the Lord himself, but he has also placed family and friends alongside us to stand with us and to support us and to show care. And we do, of course, find comfort from our families. Families who face a common loss do come together, and there is indeed great value in being together. There's no doubt over the next few days and weeks, there'll be times when Moira and the family will come across old photographs, and they will help to recount all sorts of stories and personal reflections of Joe. They'll laugh together, and of course they will cry and weep together, for that's the strange mixture of emotions, isn't it, that we feel during these particular times. And so we do find comfort from the family unit and that shared sense of loss. We also find comfort from our memories, these recollections of a life that has touched us in a special way. And here's a few memories of Joe. Joe was an only child living with Dad, also named Joe, and his mum Martha. The family home was in the Partick area of Glasgow, And Joe was just 4 years of age when World War II broke out in 1939. You will know that Glasgow became the target for some of the German bombing raids. The Partick area was an obvious target with the shipbuilding and other industries close to hand. And we would understand that whole area better with the term the Clydebank Blitz. It was a fearful and a very anxious time for families, and of course for a wee boy such as Joe. The family tried their best to give Joe some stability and some fun, so he was enrolled with the Boys' Brigade. Joe really took to this, so much so it would have a long, long-lasting and character-building time for him. He continued his involvement into adult life and actually took on the responsibility as captain. And we are sure, and we are very positive, that he had positive influence on the boys and his fellow officers of the BB throughout those many years. The Boys' Brigade started in Glasgow in 1883 by Sir William Smith to improve the moral fibre of rough and unruly boys of the time. Now, Joe was never in that category, but he did enjoy and benefit from the time with the brigade. Interestingly, you will know the Boys' Brigade had a motto taken from the Bible, from the book of Hebrews, sure and steadfast. And in many ways, that sums up Joe's character and his personality, sure and steadfast. I was also intrigued to learn that the official object and aim of the Boys' Brigade at that time was for the advancement of Christ's kingdom amongst boys and the promotion of habits of obedience, reverence, discipline, self-respect, and all that tends towards a true Christian manliness. I don't know if that's the motto now or whether we get away with that now. That's what it was when Joe was involved, and that certainly had such a deep impression on Joe Simpson. At the age of just 12, Joe would need to draw on some of these characteristics when his father, Joe, died. Family life, of course, changed, and soon young Joe would need to play a larger part at home with his mum. And after schooling, he learned his trade as a joiner, working hard to acquire the skills he would use throughout the whole of his life. Joe was a perfectionist, so every dovetail joint, every mitre had to be just right. When the war finished, National Service was in operation, and it called upon Joe's services. He was appointed to the Royal Electrical and Mechanical Engineers Corps, the REME. His BB years maybe prepared him well for this, for he actually did very well in National Service because he won the Best Recruit Medal. And when we hear of the National Service, we automatically think of exotic travelling, sunny places, exciting adventures abroad. But sadly, the farthest Joe reached was his time in Dorset, down in the south coast. And I'm sure there was a bit of a disappointment for that, but for the boy from Partick, maybe Dorset was excitement enough. From younger years, Joe carried a love for music and in due time, dancing too. With National Service over, Joe obviously looked to his future, and this was helped and mapped out in part when he met and married Rena. Family arrived soon after with Yvonne and Lorraine and Iain. They set up their family home in Knightswood, Glasgow. Sadly, tragically, Rena suffered serious ill health with kidney problems. A kidney transplant was attempted, but unfortunately this was not successful. Rena was just 38 years of old. Age when she passed away. Joe lost his young wife and the children. They lost their loving mum. Yvonne, age 12, Lorraine and Iain, just 9 years old. Difficult and tragic days when Joe again had to draw on his deepest resources for himself and for his young family. Moy than you, Joe, through work and in due time was able to help and to support the family as best she could. And Joe and Moira's relationship developed thereafter, and they found in each other companionship and a soulmate to share their future lives. And so they did. They were married in 1974 and would have been blessed to celebrate their 47th year of marriage anniversary later this year. The 1960s and 70s were dramatic growth years for the new town of East Kilbride. The Development Corporation had been formed and commissioned to construct housing and factories to cope with the influx of thousands of workers and families from the Glasgow and the Lanarkshire areas. Joe was successful in obtaining a job there. Another advantage was that a house was part of the arrangement. So the family were able to make a fresh start and put down roots in the St Leonard's area of the town. And Joe took his skills and his hard-working attitude and contributed so well for many years, finally working in the estates department, overseeing the corporation's factories and care and maintenance. Through his time with the BB and as an organist in Partick Baptist Church, Joe was exposed to the preaching and the teaching of Bible stories and truths. And slowly and surely, these filtered into his mind and deep into his heart, and they took root there. His Christian faith was real and was shown through his servant's heart, his willingness to help wherever and whenever he could, using his musical gifts to play the organ and the keyboard in the churches that he attended, and his willingness to use his practical joinery skills and abilities to help so many folks. And his and Moira's willingness to show biblical hospitality in their homes again and again to countless folks, to go the extra mile time and time again. Joe never pushed himself up front in church, for he didn't see himself in that role. He was a practical man who gave of his times, of his skills and his energies, and as we read in Colossians, as unto the Lord. I recall a very interesting fact from the Old Testament, the book of Exodus, when God blessed a man named Bezalel with special skills, abilities, and craftsmanship to construct the tabernacle where God would come and dwell while the nation were wandering those 40 years in the wilderness. And when you read of this account, the plans and the details for the construction of the tabernacle were astonishing, and Bezalel finished the work exactly as God intended. Now, Joe had skills, but he had to put in time to learn and to hone them. But I think we can safely say that Joe and Bezalel had some things in common. They were both perfectionists. No shabby work, no that will do attitude, and they both had a heart and a willingness to finish the work, and for Joe, doubly so, when working in churches. God's house, for God's people. He would make sure that everything was done just right. Westwood Hill Church in East Kilbride opened our doors in 1978, and it was shortly after that that Joe and Moira and the family joined with us. We again saw the servant's heart attitude in practice throughout Joe and Moira's time with us, serving as a deacon, heading up the fabric group, providing music to help and to enhance our praise and our worship, offering an open door, an open home for our youth fellowship, young people, constructing a working kitchen in the church, which would be used time and time again for meals and catering, weddings and different events, which many folks enjoyed and found benefit from. As we say, Joe was a perfectionist. Yes, that was true. But like all of us, Joe did have some shortcomings. For example, in all of their married life, I'm told, Joe only made Moira 2 meals. And when she was ill, he attempted as best he could to give her a fried egg. And Moira kept that egg in the fridge for the next 5 days. maybe as evidence or maybe as a souvenir, I just don't know. The loft area in Joe's homes were his personal go-to spaces. He was never good at throwing bits and pieces away, just in case he might need them. Everything he might possibly need was in his loft. And the old phrase, even the kitchen sink, was true of Joe, for Joe kept one up in his loft also. Now, we enjoyed Joe and Moira's fellowship at Westwood Hill for many years, and we were, of course, sorry to see them leave to move and to set up home with your good selves here in Maddiston in 1994. And as well as all of their belongings, we know that they both brought all I have outlined earlier in terms of their servants' hearts and their willingness to serve. And they would be put to good use here, I'm sure. There's no doubt Joe's greatest love and the most precious times were with his family. Family gatherings, family holidays here and abroad, the big family events, marriages and births, children, grandchildren, great-grandchildren. And they are one of the main blessings spoken of in the Bible. And Joe was indeed blessed many times over. Sarah, as one of those grandchildren, will come shortly and speak on behalf of the younger members of the family. And this has been mentioned, if it all works well, it'll be lovely to hear from Iain all the way from Indonesia. Families are indeed a blessing, not only through happy and joyful times, but I would suggest a loving, a caring family during times of ill health is absolutely essential. As we know, Joe's health started to decline some time ago, and he fought so hard to keep that outward appearance, that smart outward appearance of Joe that we all love so well. However, gradually he became weaker and frailer. And throughout all of that time, the family came and they supported as best they could, showed their love around Joe's bed. They brought their love. They shared Christian music and singing, which Joe loved and appreciated so much. The Lord chose to close Joe's life of 86 years just a few days ago and to welcome him to his new home, a place prepared by the Lord himself, where Joe is now enjoying the presence of Christ, his Saviour, in a new environment, and he will do so now for all of eternity. Before I hand over to Sarah, Moira and the family wish me to thank so many for the cards and the flowers, the baking, and for your love, your prayers and your kind thoughts. They particularly thank those who showed remarkable care and compassion to Joe in his latter days. And there's always a danger of missing out a name, but Moira would like me to say thank you to Joe's carers who tended him so well four times each day. Callum and Hazel, David, Sandra, Becky and Margaret. And also to the district nurses, Jennifer, Angela and Laura. The Bible is very clear as to and also to the two sisters, Teresa and Anne, and to good friend Nan. Your care and your help was wonderful and it was greatly, greatly appreciated. And of course, to Yvonne and Alistair, to Lorraine and Kevin, and to each of your dear families. And we do especially remember Iain, presently in Indonesia and unable physically to be with us today, but is watching and will join with us through the miracle of online technology. So we do especially pray for Iain, physically so far away, but like so many here, with a heavy heart, and very much with us in thought. To the dearest family and friends, yes, there is grief and there is sorrow today, but we do pray that some of these thoughts and more fond memories that you will have of Joe Simpson will indeed soften those inner feelings of loss, and more so as the Lord himself comes near and pours in his healing and his soothing for saddened hearts. Amen.
Granda Simpson, or Grandad Simpson. I'm speaking today on behalf of the grandchildren and great-grandchildren, sharing something about what he meant to each of us and how grateful we are to have had him as our granda and granddad. Each of the grandchildren have contributed to what I will share. I start first with Granda's only grandson, Iain. He said, "I hope I can be half the gentleman that you were, and I will miss being able to learn from you, to watch how you acted and carried yourself, your gentleness. I treasure the time we spent together, the many trips to the Transport Museum. We will all miss you greatly, from your favourite grandson." Shona added, "We are all very grateful for the many photos and videos taken of us as children. Granda always seemed to have a camcorder or a camera. I have a huge sense of pride when talking about him. Everyone seemed to know him and had a story to tell about something he'd built in their house." Chloe shared the word amazing. She considered her granddad as always caring and kind. I know Chloe really valued spending precious time with him in his last few days. Erin shared these words. "Our time together was short, but the memories created with you, Grandad, will be cherished forever. All the times building furniture, having three-course dinners that Gran would whip up in no time to feed the 5,000, and just having amazing time together. You were such a true gentleman and a man I was so proud to call my granddad. You mean so much to me, and I will remember every memory for the rest of my life. Your name and memory will live on in my little boy's life, and he will know all about you and love you as much as I did. You'll always hold a special place in my heart. Love you and forever and always." My sister Katrina talked about how she remembers Gran saying that every time Granda saw an ambulance, he would look in to see if it was her in it, driving it, or not in the ambulance. She shared that it meant a lot to know that he was proud of me. And I know too that he was proud of her, and that he benefited from her caring nature and professional skills. My other sister Joanna shared that her favourite memory is when Gran and Granda took her and Shona to Disneyland Paris. They performed a show for them on their holiday. If I can get my next page here. And the lyrics were, "We're having a party, we're having a blast, we're having a good time, we're having a ball. Let's enjoy the fun while it lasts." Granda always remembered the song, and it brought him joy to know how much the girls had loved their trip with him. Granda did enjoy life, Joe says. Joe also shared how dearly her children loved their great-granda. My memories of Granda include dancing with him in a posh restaurant on holiday as a teenager when we went with Gran and Granda too. And also of David and I being taught how to waltz in preparation for our own wedding. He was someone who would happily share his skills without making you feel embarrassed or silly for asking. I also personally experienced the way that he welcomed people. I only ever remember Gran and Granda being interested, courteous, and generous to my now husband, David. And I know that they've treated many people who visited their home exactly the same way. We're eternally grateful for that, even if we're not always quick to see. I know David is going to miss having someone to talk about lawns with. My own children too loved visiting their great Granda and were always happy to climb onto his lap for a cuddle. I'm pretty sure that in his last days, the little ones were the ones who got the biggest smiles from him. Despite his suffering, his face always lit up when they walked into the room. If I was to sum up our granda in just a few words, I would say he was a loyal, hardworking, honest gentleman. As a couple, my gran and granda were hospitable, caring, loving, and sacrificial. They worked as a team, and we saw that very clearly whenever we visited. They care deeply for their family, and although we haven't always made life easy for them, I know that above all, they are very proud and very protective of their family. Their example demonstrates the truth of their Christian life and their Christian faith, and there are not many couples today out there that you could say the same words as I've said today of them. I just want to finish with the verses from Matthew 25. His master replied, "Well done, good and faithful servant. You've been faithful with a few things, and I will put you in charge of many things. Come and share your master's happiness.
Thank you, Sarah. And hopefully now we can get Ian's mic turned on and Ian will be able to say a few words. Ian.
Hi, good morning, everyone. As you know, unfortunately, I can't join you there. But I'm just glad I can manage to contribute to my father's time here. So where do I start? To try and, within 2 or 3 minutes, explain the kind of father that I had and as a family had. It's difficult to explain in 2 or 3 minutes. I mean, 2 or 3 hours would not be enough. But you hear a lot of people saying my father was a gentleman. And in every possible sense of that word, yes, he was an absolute gentleman. He taught me as a son how to love as a man, how to love as a gentleman, and how to treat people, how to work hard, how to try and influence other people's lives. And if I could possibly even think that I could be half the man that my father was, I could be in some way happy. But to live up to a man like Joe Simpson, of the strong moral character he had, the strong principles he had, the strong hard work ethic he had, it's very difficult to follow a man like that. He loved and cared for his whole family. And thank you, Willie and Sarah, for your kind words. And I just reflect on what you're saying, that yes, he worked hard for his family, he adored his family, his many grandchildren, great-grandchildren, all adored him. My two sisters, myself, just were so proud of a father like my dad. He was a man that just taught everybody how to live. He worked hard, he would give his life for anyone. He would do anything he could to help you, whatever he could. And I personally know I put my father through a lot of pain through some of the things I did in my life. But I know, no matter what, he loved me unconditionally. And as I say, if I thought I could even be half a man that my father was, I could be happy. Yes, he worked hard. I've had so many memories, even when I was an apprentice. I worked in some jobs my father was in charge of. And everyone I knew, even had always kind words. Oh, that Joe Simpson's a lovely man. And it always made me proud to know that people respected my dad for the kind of man he was. His band life, his music life, even a friend of mine many years ago, I was in her house, and her mother said, oh, your dad's Joe Simpson. He's a lovely man. He played for us at the Women's Guild in St. Leonard's Hall. And things like that always touched me, always gave me a sense of pride, as I say, of how he was as a man. That no matter what area of his life, whether it was work life, his music life, his family life, he was respected and loved by everybody that knew him. As I say, I'm just so sad that I can't be there today, but as we all know, the circumstances kind of out of with our control just made it too difficult to get back. But I just want to hold you all and just thank you all for everything you've done for my father. And I just hope soon I can get back and we can celebrate as a family the life of my dad and celebrate the kind of man he was. So I'll just leave it at that and I'll let you go on. Okay, so thank you all. Take care. Love you all. Bless you all. Thank you.
Thank you, Ian. And I'll ask now Harry Strang from the church here in Maddiston, perhaps now, to come and say a few words about Joe's time here with us in Maddiston. Harry.
Thank you, Tim. It's indeed a privilege for me to be asked this morning to speak something about Joe. Joe and Moira came to Maddiston in 1994. In no time at all were they both involved and became valued members of the church here in Maddiston. When they arrived, we were in the midst of making some major alterations to the church building, and Joe came into fellowship at the right time. If I remember correctly, Joe was responsible for fitting the kitchen plus other joinery work, and although he had a good number of building assistants, he needed to be there all the time. And I say that kindly, not to hurt any of those who were helping him at the time. And needless to say, the work that he done was done perfectly. Joe was not only a quality tradesman, he was also musical. And if and when needed, he was always willing to help us here in the church. Over a number of years, a number of men of a certain age would meet on a Tuesday morning for coffee. Our discussions would range from spiritual to gardening and everything else in between. Joe was a regular attender there until his health meant he couldn't join us. But up until then, to the very end, Joe was always able for his bacon roll in the morning. On a Thursday morning, we had a cafe here in the church annex, and many folk from the church and the village attended that. And again, Joe was a regular attender there as well. And it was amusing in the morning when Joe would come in. There were always folks here early in the morning for the start of that coffee. And there was a table just behind the door there. And there were a couple used to sit at that table, a couple of friends from the village. And another lady from the church would sit and talk with them. And then when I came in, that lady would move away from the table and leave me to speak to the couple. And then later on, Joe would come in. And as Joe came in, we just moved back and made room for Joe to get into that special seat there. And he came in and sat there. And he sat throughout that coffee morning, right until the end. But of course, he was always able on that morning to have his scone with butter and jam. He always enjoyed that. But of course, these events had to stop because of the present situation. I've mentioned Joe's help practically and socially in the church here, but he also was a faithful attender at all the church gatherings. And if I were asked to what my thoughts were of Joe since I came to know him, I would have to say this: as far as I knew Joe, he was our dear brother beloved. And he's going to be missed by many. No matter what he did, he was always there to help. And I would ask that you continue to pray for Moira in the days that lie ahead. For her loving husband, she's going to miss him. And so are we in the church here in Maddiston. He was a tremendous help to us, and he's going to be a tremendous miss. And I'm just going to take a few moments to read a few verses of scripture what I've been asked to mention this morning. And first of all, there are a few verses from John chapter 14, and it says this: "Do not let your hearts be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. My Father's house has many rooms. If it were not so, would I have told you, but I am going there to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come back and take you to be with me, that you may also be with me where I am. You know the way to the place where I am going." Thomas said to him, "Lord, we do not know where you are going, so how can we know the way?" Jesus answered, "I am the way, and the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father except through me." And there are a few verses I'm going to read from 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, and it says this: "Brothers and sisters, we do not want you to be uninformed about those who sleep in death, so that you do not grieve like the rest of mankind who have no hope. For we believe that Jesus died and rose again, and so we believe that God will bring with Jesus those who have fallen asleep in him. According to the Lord's word, we tell you that we who are still alive, who are left until the coming of the Lord, will certainly not precede those who have fallen asleep. For the Lord himself will come down from heaven with a loud command, with the voice of the archangel, and with the trumpet call of God, and the dead in Christ will rise first. After that, we who are still alive and are left will be caught up together to meet with him in the clouds, to meet the Lord there, and so we will be forever with the Lord. Therefore, I encourage you to encourage one another with these words. Amen.
Thank you, Harry. And perhaps we'll have our final hymn, which is, Will Your Anchor Hold? Shall we pray? Father, we thank you for this time that we've been able to remember your faithful servant, Joe. We thank you for his life, for his love, for his care, and for his friendship. We ask that you may comfort Moira and the rest of the family, those present and absent because of the restrictions. We thank you, Father, for the assurance that Joe is safe with you today, and that he is more alive now than he has ever been. Grant us peace at this time and help us to rest on your promises. We pray, Father, that our hearts may not be troubled, that we may trust in you. And now to him who is able to keep us from stumbling and to present us before his glorious presence without fault and with great joy, the only God, our Saviour, be glory, majesty, power and authority through Jesus Christ our Lord, before all ages, now and forevermore. Amen. Our service here now is complete, and we will continue down at the crematorium. Just a reminder, we need to leave through this door, and I'll perhaps ask Willie and Harry to lead the family and friends out. And after you've left, I'll ask the funeral directors to lead Joe out the front door, so you may want to just stand at the bottom of the drive. Thank you.